И солдайност са ключовите думи, които ни събрахте днес. Благодаря ви, скъпи пчелари, че продължавате да не отстъпвате пред трудностите и да вървите по неравния път за оздравяване на пчеларския сектор. Искам специално да благодаря на министър Десислава Танева. Нейното участие днес е силно послание за желанието на институционално ниво, законодателна и изпълнителна власт да дискутира важните въпроси, но и най-вече да намира дава отговори. За нас, с нас също така са и четирима чуждестранни експерти от Белгия, Германия, Словения и Финландия. Искам сърдечно да им благодаря за това, че приеха поканата, че са в Плевен, че днес ще представят опита на своите страни по отношение на пчеларския сектор. Сигурна съм, че тяхното участие ще допринесе за това да споделим добри практики, да почерпим опит от други, но и още веднъж ясно да защитим българската специфика на пчеларския сектор, да го направим по-достъпен, по-познат за други, така че заедно и на европейско ниво да вървим напред. Днешната конференция е още една крачка напред. Сигурна съм, че голяма част от вас много ясно си спомнят конференцията в Несебър. Тук е момента да отдам чест и наистина да благодаря на господин Кирил Киров за това, че е двигател сърце на това нещата е в пчеларски сектор да продължава да се случва. Да продължаваме с младостта на духа, си хора от различни поколения да сме обединени, хора от различни страни, за да продължим да дърпаме импулс и да правим пчеларския сектор не само още по-познат на другите, но и да усетим силата на цялата му добавена стойност, неговата жизнена важност. Знаем много добре, че от Несебър решихме да променим подхода. Затова и аз днес ще бъда максимално откровена с вас. Няма да настоявам на думичката национална една организация. Няма да я повтарям много. За мен е важно във всеки един от нас да витае мисълта и духа на обединение. Нека продължим с това, което дефинирахме като подход на тези конференции. да очертаем приоритети, имаме резолюция с ясно поставени задачи. Всяка една от точките на този документ е задача за всеки един от нас. От институции до отделни страни членки и до местното и регионалното ниво. В нея много ясно идентифицирахме какви са общите предизвикателства, с които искаме да се справим. Сигурна съм, че по пътя, търсейки решението за тях, още по-ясно ще се открои и необходимостта от това да има обединение, за да може решенията да станат по-бързи, отговорите на предизвикателствата да бъдат по-конкретни. Знам, че пътят е дълъг. Знам, че имаме още много дискусии да проведем. Но това, което ми дава много сили, че те се случват. Случват се, защото тук сме обединени от желанието нещата в сектора да се случват по-динамично, да можем всички заедно да получаваме още по-голяма подкрепа от европейско до местно ниво, но и най-вече всички ясно да различим краткосрочното от дългосрочното. Затова и днешната конференция носи това положително название – пътят напред. Аз съм сигурна, че в тези две ключови думи има основните послания на всичко случило се до сега в сектора и това, което искаме да се случи. Да, пътят е дълъг. Пътят за това да продължим да следваме ангажиментите, които поемаме. Да продължим да даваме отговори на въпросите, които са общовалидни. Не само за България, но и за целия Европейски съюз. И пътят е напред. Но напред означава да имаме смелостта и куража, да вперваме поглед в миналото, да правим поуки, да си правим изводи, да видим положителното, да не се страхуваме от отрицателното и само благодарение и на добрата практика в дискусия с други, да сумеем да отсеем онова, което ще ни помогне по-бързо да се случи това напред. Затова за мен основният резултат от тази конференция, който очакваме да продължим да осъзнаваме ясно необходимостта от единни действия, за да могат да бъдат отстоявани силно позициите на пчеларския сектор в България и в Европа. Сега на всички ни е ясно, че е важно да проявим воля, разбиране, сътрудничество, диалог, за да могат нещата да бъдат изведени до положителен резултат. В това отношение искам лично да споделя каква подкрепа може да очаквате от Европейски парламент. За мен е изключителна чест, че в Европейски парламент за първи път от прякото избиране на институцията 79-та година, подкрепена от всички политически групи, беше идеята ми за създаване на работна група «Пчеларство и здраве на пчелите». Имам честа да председателствам тази група. За мен по този начин излъчваме много силен сигнал. Имаме още едно звено в институция, която е съзаконодател, когато става въпрос за обща селскостопанска политика. Още едно звено, в което гласът на пчеларите, на експертите, заедно с тези, от които зависи вземането на решението, се чува. Тук искам специално да благодаря на българските пчелари, които откриха първото издание, първата работна среща на тази група и много ясно показаха и на останалите пчелари в другите европейски страни, че нашите проблеми са общи, имаме специфични предизвикателства, но това в никакъв случай не ни пречи, не ни поставя пречка за това да погледнем към другите, да сме отворени към тях и да търсим заедно решение. Друг много силен момент от институционалния живот на Европейския парламент, това е Европейската седмица на пчелите и опрашването в Брюксел, чийто организатор бях през 2015 година и ще бъда и през тази 2016. През изданието 2015 година наш почетен гост беше министър на земеделието и храните на България, госпожа Десислава Танева. Отново България беше на трибуната. Отново България заяви ясно отношение към проблемите на пчеларския сектор. За мен и това е важно като промяна, да продължава, да се чува гласът. Иначе ще продължим да си говорим колко е богато видовото ни разнообразие на мед и пчелни продукции, колко невероятна е природата ни, колко всеотдайни и работливи са пчеларите ни, но това трябва да получи признание. За мен основна цел и на тези конференции това, което се случва в България, да получи видимост, да получи популяризиране и на европейско ниво. И тук мисля, че България много ясно показва пример как, говорейки на един глас и в съвета на министрите, и в Европейски парламент, и в регионите, там където се случват нещата, тук на местно ниво, можем да направим така, че посланията ни да се чуват много по-ясно. Конструктивен диалог можем да продължим да дефинираме формулата за успешния път напред. Политиците ни с инструментите на законодателството, експертите с знанията си, науката с научните си изследвания, пчеларите с опита си и с житейската мъдрост. Мисля, че тук е мястото да кажем, че трябва да продължим напред към търсенето на това сътрудничество. Не случайно споменах Европейската седмица на пчелата, която организирам в Брюксел. Изданието 2015 година беше посветено на така наречените модели на сътрудничество между земеделски производители и пчелари. Това е един от приоритетите, който ще остане за нас през 2016 година. Важно е този диалог да се случва. Той не е спонтанен, той не е вътрешно вроден, но той може да се случи. Затова съм сигурна, че тук експертите, които във вторият панел, посветен на България, на ситуацията в сектора, ще ни дадат много ясни, много точни информации за това специфично в България, как стоят нещата и как можем да допринесем за намиране на решение. Ще завърша с това, което и често господин Киров, мой вдъхновител, когато става въпрос за пчеларския сектор, прави като сравнение. Необходима ни организация, която, за пример, има на организацията на едно пчелно семейство. Да действаме като тях, обединени, организирано, с ясни задачи, с конкретни ангажименти. Ключовата дума наистина тук ще очаквам да излезе от самата конференция. Аз няма да настоявам за това каква тя да бъде. Мисля, че посланията за всички ни трябва да бъдат още веднъж, че само с общи усилия, с активни действия можем да успеем да се справим с предизвикателствата пред пчеларския сектор. Благодаря на всички предварително и пожелавам изключително резултат на дискусия. Благодаря ви.
Давам думата на госпожа Танева, министър на земеделието, за приветствие.
Аз мисля, че ще посиламе бизнеса. Добър ден на всички от мен. Първо искам да поздравя всички за това, че са участници в тази конференция и на Мария Добрилов като нейен инициатор. Благодаря на нашите, тъй като и аз съм гост, но като българи да кажем добре дошли на чуждестранните ни гости. И съм сигурна, че ако вие успеете от този дебат да се стремите да извлечете какво ние може да подобрим тук и да направим тук, което вече като път е извървял при тях, днес е идеалната възможност. Благодаря за тяхното присъствие и ще се радвам общността в България също да види как функционира сектора в тези страни, в Европа и как няма нищо чак толкова по-различно и това как да продължим, до какво да достигнем като развитие се състои и се крие в това как ние ще подходим към проблемите, които имаме тук у нас. Дали ще се обединим да търсим решения и да приложим модели, които успешно функционират в развити страни, или ще търсим нечия външна, чужда помощ или на който и да било. И се надявам, че тази конференция ще даде резултат в осъзнаването на необходимостта от обединението, за да може производителя да получи по-високата част от дохода на произведения от него продукт и стигнал до крайния потребител. Аз съм тук от сутринта, и виждам, че участниците са почти същите, които бяха и сутринта на изложението, и ще спестя всички цифри, които представят сутринта. Те говорят категорично в една и съща посока, няма цифра в обратен тренд. Увеличаване на всичко, на стопанствата, на производството, на обемите, 350 земеделски стопани, пчелари са кандидатствали по отделните мерки през миналата година, инвестиционни. Всичко говори за интерес към развитие на този отрасъл. Надявам се, че ще успеем да постигнем единение в бранша, за да се приложат модели, които биха довели до по-висока доход на самите земеделски стопани. В тази връзка, през тази година и следващата, чрез Държавен фонд земеделие, ще предложим и допълнителни мерки, част от новата програма за развитие на селските райони, които да стимулират създаването и функционирането в 5-годишен период на такива модели. Надявам се това да е успешно. Аз се извинявам, че няма да мога да остана, но наистина аз от сутринта съм тук в Министерството, трябва да пристигна преди края на работния ден, поради ежедневните задължения, които имам. Тук на ваше разположение е експертният екип от Министерството на земеделието и храните и колеги, които работят в комуникация по отделни закони и наредби, при нас ги познават отлично. Те могат да отговорят на всички ваши въпроси относно това какво се прави, каква е процедурата, за каквото и да било и какви са сроковете. Всичко, което като консенсусно стигнато предложение към държавата се формира в тази конференция днес, ние ще го разгледаме така, както работим от година в открит диалог с наистина много добрите организации. Повярвайте ми, това затруднява преди всичко нас. Смятам, че това, което е възможно за подобряване на средата, ние бихме го направили. Очакваме до края на месеца пълна яснота и одобрение от комисията на нотификацията на програмата за развитие на селските райони в частта на новата мярка в обхвата на агроекология и климат, осигуряване на разнообразие, разнообразна паша на пчелите, и в сроковете на кампанията по директни плащания в тази година да можем да приложим мярката и тя да стигне в крайна сметка до пчелните семейства. Пожелавам успех и, разбира се, успех на всички в търсене на и усъвършенстване на моделите, по които работим при нас.
Сега думата ще дадам на господин Етиан Грамон, председател на научната комисия на Бимондия, пчеларски технологии и качества, председател на работната група МЕД на Европейската асоциация на земеделските производители, Копа Коджека Хали. Заповядайте, господин Грамон. Изпратим се аплодисменти, госпожа Танева.
Such a number of people are the rooms. and to speak of a subject is very important today, is the organization of the Keeping Association. And so my wish is to present you very shortly the beekeeping in Europe, and let's build together European beekeeping. And you will see we have a very brief overview of the actual situation of European beekeeping. After we will see more little details about beekeeping and their association, how we can find solutions, and what can we do concretely. So it will be short, of course. I prefer to answer the questions. First of all, the vision of the European beekeeping. What's European beekeeping? Beekeeping is 500,000 of beekeepers here, and you see it's only 5 persons at more than 150 hives. 150 hives is a professional level. It's not really professional level, but it gives an idea of the intensity of the activity. The number of hives you see is nearly 16 million hives. It's a lot, but we can increase this number. I think it's not enough. On the market. Honey markets, 200,000 tons of honey produced every year. We are the second producer in the world. This we don't know. Usually we produce our eggs, our honey, but we are the second producer on the world market. It's very important to know. But we import a lot of honey too. 175,000 tons. So what does it mean? The market is completely open. This is the reality. And the consumption of honey increased every year. This was honey too. So this is a very big challenge. How can we increase the production of honey in Europe? Pollination. You know that honey is just a little part of the what can bring the bees for the society. Agriculture without bees can be very problematic. And so pollination represents, you see the number of billions, nearly 15 billion euros. You see, it's completely crazy amounts. 10% of the alimentary value of all the agricultural production. It's crazy. And this is only for agricultural product, but if you consider environments with wild plants, there it's the pollination with all the pollinators, not only the male first bee, but all the pollinators, it's 80% of these plants are surviving. It's the survive is linked to the bees. So it's very important. Yes. European aids for beekeeping, this you know, it's 33 million euro, but I hope that it will increase. I don't know, the decision is for... Not yet. I know, it's 36, I hope. Why not? And, we will see, you have to answer. Pathology, this is a... You see, the problem there is, you know, we have... Everybody has a power in his eyes, and the number of products is very limited. Usually, the medium of the number of products in the different countries is only 3. I mean, when you compare this with the pigs, 426, for the ducks, 522, for the bees, 3. You see, it's completely crazy, this situation. So we have no correct treatment actually to treat our bees. It really depends from one country to another, but a lot of countries have very big difficulties for this. But we have, due to the Commission and the Parliament, they pushed during this last year and they developed a European reference laboratory for bee pathology. So this is moving in the good direction. But we have the bee decline, and I hear everywhere in all the country in Europe we lose a lot of bees. There it's average 15 persons, but in some country it can be higher than 40 persons. In Belgium, my country, last winter we lose 43 persons of bee colony. 43 persons, it's crazy. And the beekeeper after that are completely killed. You can imagine. Here, just I will show you some maps. of the density of the beekeeper. And so you see, Germany is very, it's on the left, it's the number of beekeeper per 100 square kilometer, and on the right, it's the percentage of professional beekeepers. So you can see two different maps. The professionals are in the south part of Europe, most of them, and the density of the beekeepers is more here. In Germany, you see, Czechy, these kind of countries are very important for the number of beekeepers. Evolution of the number of beekeepers, you see, every year it's more, we increase the number. And you see in Bulgaria there is a very strange figure, not like in the other country in Europe, but it depends. It's very different from one country to another. All these statistics must be much more clear during the next mandate of the new program. All the member states, they will have very clear rules to fulfill the forms. And I think a lot of things will change in the future. This is the repartition, and you see where is Bulgaria. Yes, I think Bulgaria is very important for beekeeping in Europe. You are very important. This is true, because the number of hives is important, and I listened today that the number of hives in 1 year increased of 23%. So it's increased, it's an incredible increase. But it's possible, with dynamism, we arrive to evidence. And you see that in the east part of Europe, the number of hives increased every year a lot, because a lot of new professional beekeepers arrive on the market. And this is a very big change. We see those hives, there here you have the density of the hives. And you see that the highest density is in Hungary, there it's all the data, but now there are 13 hives per square kilometer. So it's the highest density of hives in Europe. This is very high, it's limit, because there at this level the sanitary problem arrived. It's just at the border. But you see, in a country like Spain, who produce a lot of honey, the density is not so high. And in France, no, really not. I was thinking of Finland there. It's very low, but the country is very, very big. I will be killed by my neighbor there. So, but you see, I think here in this country, the density is completely normal. For your environment, you can increase the number of hives. It's not a problem. When you see the Hungary, you have much more intensive agriculture than here, and they have 13 hives per kilometer, square kilometer. This is the number of hives, and there you see also very big variation. And, I think all these things will be stabilized in the future. It's not so much, it's not so important. Here you see it's Spain was the first, and your country is completely it's in a good situation there. At the European level. And now we will see the beekeeper. This is more important because the beekeeper is the base. Without beekeeper, we have no bees and we have nothing. So the beekeeper is the base of the circuit. And there we can speak of at the local, we have beekeepers, so, and some beekeepers stay alone and work alone. And means they have nothing and just do their job and they sell their honey just in their bag. It's possible. But you have local association. And there, this, you can find very big difference between different associations in different countries. One of the most impressive countries is Portugal. There you know that in this country, they have kind of cooperatives. And these cooperatives, they do nearly everything for the beekeeper. They visit all the beekeepers twice a year. They give them the product, the medicine. They sell their honey, they collect, they harvest the honey, they do everything for them. And so it's like just beekeeper, they have to maintain their hives and to visit their hives. So you can push the service very, very far. In all countries, you see all the service that can offer the some section. It's some analyze of honey, some analyze of pathology. You have you can have the books, you can have trips, you have a lot of different services that you can offer to the beekeeper. This is the local sector. It's very important. And you have also at a very local sector the school for the beekeeper. When you are not beekeeper, you begin to be a beekeeper, you need help and you need very good advice. And there in our country, US, I think for the volunteer, it's a very important. 4,000 beekeepers, we have 35 schools. It's a lot. Everywhere. At regional, this is also important. What can you find at the regional level? There you can find a group of association at regional level, because at the region there is some poor politics, and you can discuss with them. It's very important to be there, present in this level. You can have also the cooperative. More cooperatives, they are for the selling of money at the international market and this kind of things. It's at this level that you have to work. It's at the regional level. Without this, you don't have the strength to sell outside. You have also development center and technical assistance. There, it's at this very good level to put this kind of structure in place. You see, in France, every region they have what you call ADA. It's a development association for beekeeping. So it's a good example of what you can do. At national level, there also you can group the association to have one interlocutor, one person who represents all the beekeepers at a national level. It's very important to have one person. And there we have also a possibility to have interprofessional grouping with not only the beekeeper, but all the structures who are linked to the beekeeper. So the reseller and this kind of things. They can be linked together to find some activities to make promotion of money or this kind of things. It can be useful. And there you have contact at this level with all the ministries as agriculture, trade, all these are very important. And at this level you can also push the university and a research center to make some more fundamental research or applied research in your field. It's very important. Now we arrive at European level, and there we have two structures for beekeeping. It's Copacogeca, and actually the president of the working group. And there we discuss it's a farming association with all the farmers, and we are directly in link with the farming. It's very important. All the beekeepers are farmers. You have to know this. We are linked to them. We are doing the same job. We have a different, our animals are different, but we have the same problem and the same topics with medicine and all these kind of things. Our topics are the same, and we are exactly, we speak the same language when we discuss at European level. We are with the farmers. For other subjects, it's much more difficult. With the society and these kind of things, it's much more difficult. There you have also the European Professional Beekeeping Association, EPBA, but there is no permanent structure. So it's much more difficult to act. We have contact with the European Commission, with the Council, with the Parliament, with Maria Gabriel, who there is planned a job for us. We have the contact with the EFSA, with the EMEA. EFSA is the European Environmental Agency, but EFSA uses all the regulation with pesticides, and EMEA is more with the medicine. So we have contact with all these agencies. International, we have only one structure at this level, it's Apimontia. And there it's much more difficult because we have nearly no permanent international level, it's a little crazy, but you have contact there more with the FAO and the CODEX. It's also important. The link with the other partners, it's important. We have a beekeeper in the center, and there we have some structural technical assistants who are linked directly with the scientific world. We have administration, politics, everything must be linked with the beekeeper. Without this, you didn't exist. Economy, cooperative. I tell you, we are farmers too. All the farming associations, they are there. All the reseller, the packager, and all these kind of things, you must have contact. You like them or not, it's not a problem. You have to discuss with them. And you have also environmental association. They are present and they can help you on some certain topics. And you have also the beekeeper in the other countries. And you must have contact. So you see, it's like you have to create a synergy between all these persons. And this is what I explained to you, it's just for the French part of Belgium. You see, it's crazy. You see a lot of interrelation. The different associations, the same or less, lot of association, all start at our little school for the beginner and the importance of each of one. And you see, it's crazy to manage this. It's really difficult. But we find solution, concrete solution, to have just one vote and one. When we have discussion with the ministry, we have just one thing to tell. And we are present to all the meetings, we are there. And we present some democratic representation at all the level, local, regional, federal, European and international. We are present everywhere. It's a very little country. France, another example. There we have, you see, the number of syndicates, I think, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9 different syndicates to represent the beekeeper. And I can tell you, they are struggling against every time. They are, oh no, they are bad, they are bad, they are bad. And when they arrive to the ministry, they tell them, okay, we discuss with you. It's completely impossible to discuss with you. So we stop. And the ministry, what do they put in place? They put an institute. And the beekeeper, they are nearly not represented in this structure. And now, all the decisions are taken by this platform. And the beekeeper, they just are consulted. It's all. So they lose all their power because they can't find an agreement together. This is very important, this example. So you have to find an agreement to be present together. Without this, you will disappear. Or some other person will take your place. And it's the case in France. Not exactly, but when you see the power that they have in the past and what the power that they have today, they are nearly no power, no decision. It will be good to find solutions. Why? First, to increase the use of pesticides and chemical toxic for bees. To decrease, sure, naturally. And to reduce monocropping and its relation to biodiversity loss. To stop increase of production cost. The loss of bee colony and necessity to have more non-productive colony. You see now in Belgium, one little beehive to compensate the risk. We need this, but it costs a lot, twice. We have to structureize the market. And you know the problem of arbitration I dealt with this morning. We have the problem of labeling and inability to trace the geographic origin. You know that we have labor with EU and a non-EU honey. What's this? Is it honey? This is the question. It is good to find solution for what? To find new solution to a beekeeper in front of climate change. What can we do? It's too dry, it's too humid, it's too... And we are not, it's not usual for us. To solve the problem of lack of technical platform, who has a beekeeper in this moving environment? This is a problem. Every year is different, and the beekeeper has to react differently. And in this case, it's very difficult for everybody. And to be directly in front of the arrival of Etina Tuida, the little beehive leader, and the development of Vespa Pelicina. To find a solution, we have to change agricultural practice. Less pesticides, less toxic pesticides, with good accreditation tests, more diversity in the crop, and crop more adapted for pollinators. Clean the market of adulterated products, put in place a traceability system and correct labeling. Obtain a better valorization of bee products by using nutrition in avitrapy. Put in place new tools that could provide beekeepers with guidance and up-to-date information on the best current practice and on the evolution of market, sanitary condition, impact of climate on the beekeeping practice. I speak a little quickly for me to translate my thinking. What can we do? It's okay. Perfect. Translators are perfect. We have to construct together, this is important. Alone, we have not enough weight, this is true. We need to bring all good ideas together in many countries of Europe. We are in Europe, we have to bring all the ideas. What can we do? We need to find good ideas and solutions with all the actors. What does it mean? Communication between all the actors, listening to the need of beekeepers. Consultation of all the persons, engagement of the decision at the decision level. When you see a minister, he has to give clear engagement. Concurrent structure with all the actors. It's not alone that you can do something. You can build something together. And this at all the level. What can you do to find the know-how? Innovating ideas, giving results, solutions to save bees and support beekeeper, to be implemented from local to European level, to work the workforce. This is sure, we need a lot of energy. And this is all of the association, not only one. All. And the persons in touch with beekeeping, not only you don't have to be specially beekeeper, some persons can be interested by beekeeping and help you a lot. And there, one key person is the good and positive leader who want to build together with a clear vision of the situation and of the topics, a good management and without conflict of interest. And to put, at European level, every country has its policy and rule by which it works. Unified, we can get exactly what we really need. Those who make the law and regulation are not beekeepers, you don't have to forget this. Unified, we will have something to say and we will be able to obtain better rights for bees, beekeeping and beekeeper, just as union level, at the union level, European level. Let's build together European beekeeper. I can think, in Belgium we have a sentence, united we stand, divided we fall. Thank you for your attention.
Благодарим, господин Брюно. Сега думата има Соня Хайнеман, заместник-председател на Българската асоциация на пчеларите в Германия.
Thank you very much for the inviting. I'm the Vice President of Bavaria and I bring you all best regards from the President of Germany, Mr. Peter Maske, and the President of Bavaria, Eckhard Radke. And I will try to explain you a little bit of the organization of the German beekeeping organization and more details about how we work in Bavaria. These are some photos from the Grüne Woche, Green Week in Berlin. I think it's the biggest trade fair for agriculture. This is our biggest organization, the Deutscher Imkerbund, founded 1907 with 83,000 members in Germany. And they work together with 19 counties. We have 16 counties or states in Germany. And in some states, there are some more organizations. At the end, on top, we have the president, we have the vice president, and we have 19 representatives of this, the states in the beekeeping organizations in Germany. Altogether we have 110,000 beekeepers and at the moment about 7 colonies per beekeeper and tendency is less. less colonies. So it do not increase, it goes down. And the average age was 2,860 years old as a beekeeper, and now the beekeeper is 56 years old. And the quantity of the woman is about 15%. The Deutsche Imkerbund, the German organization, they have also for special fields, special advisor for when we have problems with legal, or we have a person in a group for the science and selection of breeding, then also people from the professional beekeeping. We have one for advertising, and also we have the management for special honey verifications and someone for the public relation. And also we have shipping service is when the counties ask for special things, magazines to do advertising. So our head, Mr. Peter Maske, he represents our interests in Germany and in Europe and I think all over the world. And he is in contact with all the important organizations, with the ministries, he's in Brussels. Also with the very important is the farmer associations. And also they do organization for the events, like the Grüne Woche. So now we come to my work. We are the biggest organization in Germany. We have nearly 27,000 members. 15% of them we are women. We are organized with a statute. We have rights and obligations. We have a presidium. Because we have to organize 664 local bee clubs. The bee clubs are organized in a district. The districts are organized in counties. And at the end, on the top, the seven presidents. And me and the first president are the head of the Bavarian organization. We have only 6 colonies per beekeeper, and it will go down. And the beekeepers increase, but they held less bee colonies. We have in Bavaria about 165,000 beehives. The presidium, the committee is the president, the vice president, that's what I told you before, the seven persons of the district. We meet each other quarterly, 4 times a year. These are must have. And if we decide there are important things, we meet maybe 1 or 2 times more. We are in contact by email, or we have telephone conferences. One time in a year we have a big Bavarian beekeeping day, and this is on a Sunday. On the Saturday before, we have a big meeting where take part 75 representatives, and on this day the representatives bring their the wish and what we should do and how we work bring on these days they request. And everybody decides then about their wishes, about say, the work we have to do. So then we decided yes or no. We have an office in Nuremberg, and the office in Nuremberg organized the membership, statistics of the bee colonies. They do the bookkeeping, management of insurance. Insurance is a big field. They organize the website and we go, or the office goes on fairs. Also, like the Deutsche Imkerbund, we have special persons who are fit in bee hills. It is only one person, and these persons for bee hills organize their own manpower. So we have a bee hills, we have someone special for flora and for the bees. This person is, talks to the agriculture. If we need someone for the agriculture, we ask him to go there and talk to them. We have someone for the honey. We have someone for education. This is all on the top, and then these persons organize it down to the district, to the local beekeepers. Public relations, selection of bee breeding, green genetic engineering. This is Peter Maske. He is a special for the green genetic engineering. Agriculture, honey, we have a honey queen, and we have a special magazine. Financial support, where do we get our money? From the Bavarian state and from the EU. We get about nearly 1 million euro, and the most of the money comes from our state, only not from Germany, from the Bavarian states. For education, for to test the honey of pesticides, for equipment, investition. When the beekeeper starts with beekeeping, they get money. And for the varroa, but for the varroa, they will stop it next year, I think. So from the Bavarian states, there comes money for bee diseases and for the queen mating stations. For school beekeeping, we have special programs. We get now money for the ecological beekeeping, and a special work since 2008 is. Start when a person starts with beekeeping or local area, the local club get 100 euro per beekeeper. So nearly 1 million. You see from the EU, the 260,000, and the most of the money comes from the Bavarian states. And this is truly therefore because we are minimum 3 or 4 times in the ministerium and say what happens and say what we want. The aims or the target, of course, for every beekeeper are the bee colonies. Very important, where we also work on is a high education for the beekeepers. High quality for the bee products, and what we are missing is the appreciation of the activities for the beekeepers by the general public and the politicians. This is a little group because I'm a little beekeeper with 15 beehives, and but I'm in the education. Thank you very much.
Сега думава доктор Петър Космос, Асоциация на пчеларите в Словения, ръководител на развъдна програма за кърмионски пчели в Словения.
Hello to everyone. First of all, I would like to say thank you to Maria Gabriel to invite me. It's a great pleasure to be in front of you, and I will represent something, our sector, beekeeping in the Slovenia. So in the beginning, I'm also the beekeeper. I keep more than 20 years. I have about 50 colonies, so I'm not just in the morning beekeeper, I'm also in the afternoon. My speciality, it is queen breeding, so I'm on the topics of conservation Apis mellifera carnica. So in this this presentation, I will present our breeding program in Slovenia and also beekeeping extension service in Slovenia. But in the beginning, something about Slovenia. You probably know that Slovenia is a small country. We have just 2 million of the inhabitants. The total area, it is 20,000 square kilometers. So it is 4 times less people as in Bulgaria, and 5 times it is less than Bulgaria. So it's a very small country. But anyway, we have more than 10,000 beekeepers. And what is very important, it is that more than 7,500 are members of the Slovenian Beekeepers Association. This is a national association, and we have more than 210 local beekeepers association. And all these associations are joined together to this Slovenian Beekeepers Association. This association has concession for public advisory service on beekeeping, and also it is approved breeders organization. Next specialty for Slovenia beekeepers, it is that we use AGE beehives. These are these beehives which are together in these bee houses. We use it more than 90% of these beehives, and Langspot we use less than 7%. Altogether, we have about 150,000 bee colonies, so average beekeeper has around 15 bee colonies. So average, they are hobby beekeepers, and some of them, they are professional. So you probably know that in Slovenia, we breed, we have just Apis mellifera carnica. It is not allowed to use any other bee races. And our ex-president of Slovenian Beekeepers Association, Mr. Lojze Katene, who is now the co-worker of his European deputy in the same party as your Gabriela, he often said that in Slovenia, just Apis mellifera carnica has permission to fly in the air, if we are talking about honeybees. Why so widespread in our country? We believe that because it is extreme gentleness. When we are working with it, we don't need any hat or gloves. It is very gentle, and otherwise it is mountain bee, and its native range, and it is good bee for cold climates. It does not do well in areas with long hot summers. Why do we like to preserve Apis mellifera carnica? Because it is autochthonous in our region, not in, just in our region, and also in Croatia, Bosnia, Serbia, part of Romania, Hungary, also Austria. It is the most adapted to the climate condition of our region, and also on pastures which are present here. We in Slovenia, we have more than 60% of forest And this Apis mellifera carnica is very good to collect honey from the forest. It has many very valuable characteristics. In the summer it is very small colony, so in the winter. So it takes just about 12 kilo of sugar for overwintering, and in the spring it has very strong and fast spring development, so in May we already have some swarms to collect. And the biggest pasture are in May, June and July, so for us it's very important that subspecies has very fast spring development. And it is the second the most spread honeybee species in the world, therefore it should be good, otherwise it was not in this position. Therefore we have also breeding program for Apis mellifera carnica, where we have very nice written the all morphometrical characteristics for Apis mellifera carnica for queen workers and also for the drones. We also have some goals in this breeding program. First part of the goals are going in the way of conservation. We would like to conserve Apis mellifera carnica also in the future in our territory. And second part of the goals are going in the selection way. In that part of goals, we would like that Apis mellifera carnica it will be gentle, even in the same way, even in the next years. And we would like to a little bit decrease swarming behavior. You probably know that Apis mellifera carnica is tend to swarming, so we would like to do a little bit of these characteristics. And of course, we would like to increase honey production per each colony. In this this breeding program, we are collaborating with Agriculture Institute of Slovenia. So we are together, Slovenian Beekeepers Association with Agriculture Institute of Slovenia. Breeding activities are divided in three different levels. First of all, it is basic selection. For this selection, we would like that all beekeepers in the Slovenia will do it. We will try to learn them that if they found more than 2% of hybrids in their beehives, that they will recognize this and then they should change the queen in this beehive. This is basic selection. Second one, it is carried out in queen rearing apiaries. We have about 30 queen breeders who, besides basic selection, are doing also direct tests and progeny tests. And also we have third level, where is breeding queens in mating station, so it is production of mother queen. Here is one picture which is also in the summer in our beekeeping magazine published, so the breeders and also beekeepers see that nails of Apis mellifera carnica should be in these colors and without these yellow rings. This is hybrid and this is Apis mellifera gallicustica oil or buckfast. Selection criteria for queen breeders, honey production, swarming tendency, gentleness and tendency to remain healthy on the comb, borrow tolerant and racial characteristics, progeny test, each queen breeders must give 10 queens from some colonies on this progeny test. So we collect these queens, we mix it and put it to other beekeepers to evaluate, and we analyze all the data, and after one day, 1 year, we get this genetic value of this beginning colony. This is test which take a lot of time, but the values are are stronger if we compare to direct tests. And from this test we also get some information for breeding values in more years. Here are values for gentleness. You may see that in more than 20 years this characteristics is in the same level, and this is good. Here is breeding values for swarming, and you may see that we didn't yet succeed our goal, because this line goes a little bit down. We hope that after a few years it will be in going up, we hope. And here is breeding values with respect to the honey production. The lines go in the right direction, and you may see that in big difference between different years. You probably know why, but even that, in the years when it's not good for honey production, it is good to evaluate which queens is better for honey production and which one is not. So we have 30 queen breeders. We produce more than 33,000 queens each year. Mostly they are sold in our country. Some of them, they are sold in the other country, in the European Union. Nearly 2,000 are sold in different country abroad, and we have a little bit less than 400 queens which are mated on the mating station. For those who are abroad and who would like to buy our queens, here is the web page, and on this web page you can find the list of queen breeders and all the data, email, telephone numbers, and also if they have it, queens, or if they don't have it. Mostly they are sent produced queens in May, June, and July, maybe also in August. And they send it by post also to the Australia. In our country, it is also tradition to moving beehives. You may see from this picture. Nowadays we don't use horses, we use trucks. And for those beekeepers, we have this observation service. And in Slovenia, we have more than 60 this observation station, where each day it is calculated how much honey this colony bring to the colony, and on basis of this information, one beekeepers can move one truck with honeybees from one part of the Slovenia to the another. And something about our beekeeping extension in the Slovenia. Slovenia has concession to doing also this. Some task of this advisory service on beekeeping, it is advising, education and extension training of beekeepers, also education of children, and we also have a lot of projects for promotional. Here are some promotional and education projects, training of beekeepers, also education of children. We organize different beekeepers days, like days of apitherapy, beekeepers open day, day of apicosin, day of honey quality shims, apitourism, and so on. We also are present on different fairs. We organize different conferences and symposium. SAP Medica in 2010, also Koros last year. Maybe some of you remember also Apimonte 2003. It was organized in the Slovenia, in the Ljubljana, and so on. We publish education and promotion material, also movies. We have nice beekeeping live. We publish each month also beekeeping magazine, and all the members of the Slovenian Beekeepers Association get this magazine. And we have a very popular website for beekeepers, bee breeders, apiculturists, and general public. The basic objectives of promotional education activities are informing and training beekeepers and the general public about the importance of beekeeping and bees. We would like not just beekeepers, but also that public will know that it is very important to saving the bees. The bees are very important, not because of honey and other bee products, but also for food production. We are concerned for quality and safety products, and we also planting honey plants. Last year we plant a lot of lime tree also in Belgium. And here are some results. You may see that until 2008, to last year, we increased the numbers of children which are learning BTP in the school from 855 to 2,314. We also increased the number of clubs in the schools from 76 to 163. So we are present in 163 primary schools, and this is very good way how to educate community, because if you are starting with the children, then when they are learned, they learn their parents, grandparents, and this is very nice way how to learn population. And here are some results of the work. We have regulated system of education of beekeepers. Each year we educate around 300 beginners each year. And also we have a lot of lectures for the old beekeepers. And altogether around 6,000 participants we have on these lectures. We increased the number of beekeepers from 2008 until now, from 7,500 to more than 10,000. We reduced the age of structure of beekeepers. In the beginning it was 65 years, now it's less than 60 years. We increased the number of children involved in the beekeeping clubs. We increased the price of honey. In the beginning it was 4 euros, now it's more than 8 euros. And what is the most important, 80% of the honey it is sold by the beekeepers, not by the shops. So people come directly to the beekeepers and get the money. This is the best way how to get for your honey better price. We increase demands and consumption of honey. In Slovenia you may see that more than 2 kilos each inhabitants each year. This is very, very high, and we believe that with all promotional campaign we learn people that it's very healthy to eat honey and other beekeeping products, and if a lot of honey is consumed, then it's also priced a little bit higher. We increase the number of red carniolan honeybees from 12,000 to more than 37,000 queen bees. We also develop complementary activities like beekeeping tourism. Now we have certified 20 beekeeping tourism. 10 of them, ten are also in the process. This is another activity for some beekeepers who have very nice beekeeping to show this beekeeper to visitors. We change public attitudes towards beekeeping and consequently the environment because of publication of numerous articles in the media. We increase the planting of the nectar plants and the use of chemical agents in accordance with good agriculture practice. More than 2 years we didn't have any poisoning bees in the whole country. This is very good result, because some years ago, like 5 years, we have a lot of poison in our country, but now we don't have it. I mentioned our website. Here is the website of our association. Very informative. It is like portal. If you need something about, if you want to know where is forest, you see this is link. If you want to buy queens, is here link. If you want to buy honey, if you need information about apiculism, you find link here. And here is just to see how much this website is usable. Each month, last year, if you look, each month it was visited about 45,000. So each day, more than 1,500 visitors are on this webpage. This is very, very interesting. So this is all from my side. For the last slide I prepared, this is my collaborator. This is the president of our Slovenian Beekeepers Association. And this is a picture from the Apimondia from South Korea last year. we are very glad that you probably know that Slovenia gave last year also one idea for World Bee Day. We would like that United Nations will declare 20 of the May for World Bee Day. We are very glad that Apimondia confirmed this idea, and we hope that next year on the United Nations will proclaim 20 May for World Bee Day. And this will be good for all the beekeepers, because we would like that all community will talk about beekeeping, about how they are important for us, for our living. So if you are interested for this, please take this brochure. It is also outside in the table, and here is also one email. If you need my something from me, you just read me on this email and I will answer you. So this is everything from my side, so thank you for your attention.
Сега презентация ще направи господин Станислав Яс, член на проба на Финландската асоциация на пчелари. My name is Stanislav Jas, and it doesn't sound very Finnish. I was born in Czechoslovakia almost 40 years ago, but I married a Finnish lady, and now I represent Finnish beekeepers in Brussels and also here. So this is about the real Europe. I'm a fourth generation beekeeper. I always had bees at home, and I managed to keep bees in four different European countries: Czech Republic, France, Belgium, and now Finland. Currently we have 25 bee colonies, so it's a hobby or side activity for me in Finland. I would like to go until 50, maybe this year. But the main reason here is that I used to work for Kopa Kočeka. I was the secretary of the working group, and I know very well Etienne Bruno and some other people around Europe. So if I give you my presentation, it's about Finland, but you can ask me also about the European context. So I don't know how many of you were in Finland, but the beekeeping in Finland is quite different from many other countries. Finnish Beekeeping Association is the only one in the country, the only national organization. But the history was quite difficult, and it may be similar to what happens right now in Bulgaria. The association was founded during the First World War. Finland was part of Russia. It was founded in 1916. Then it was quite alright until 1930, when it disappeared. Then the Ministry of Agriculture after the war in 45 helped to reorganize the sector. So the government. But there were internal quarrels. And internal quarrels resulted in a situation where in the 60s, 1966, there was a part of the beekeepers who founded their own organization. And the Finnish Beekeepers Association as one disappeared. Okay, it continued as a small one. And only in 1984, Finnish beekeepers again united. And they are happy to be united now. They are happy to be united, even though most of them are hobby beekeepers. Part of them, about 80 in the country, are professional beekeepers. Not very much. We have right now
In the country about 3,000 beekeepers, out of which only 80 are professionals at more than 150 beehives. But they are happy to be part of this one beekeeping association. 75% of the members of the beekeepers are members of the union. The rest are not. We are not convincing them to become a member. We are just explaining what are the benefits of becoming a member. The number of colonies in Finland is quite small. If you just take the whole region of Pleven, maybe you have more beehives than in the whole Finland. It's 15,000 colonies. We have up and downs, but right now the number of colonies is increasing, mostly because of city beekeeping. But we have number one in Europe, if we don't count Norway. The average yield per colony is 40 kilos per year. It's quite surprising, because our season is quite short. The bees have 3 months to make honey. We extract honey usually once a year. But there is eternal light, very long day. The bees work almost 24 hours a day. Would you like to have a worker like that? And the winter is very challenging. I need to feed 25 kilograms of sugar for my colony to overwinter. No flies during 6 months, almost, in the north of the country. So we have specific conditions, but very good yields. And that's thanks to the nature. 2/3 of our country are covered by forest. Agriculture is not very important. Small things. And we have lots of lakes, water, moisture. Total honey production is varied. We have record yields where we have overproduction. We have bad yields, like last year, when we do not cover even the half of our consumption of honey in the country. We need to get used to it. We are very dependent on the climate. Our imports are quite significant. This is our consumption. The best is the consumption average is increasing, and it's a very positive sign. But 40% of this is covered by imported honey. Imported not only from Europe, but almost exclusively from outside Europe. But I will show you that we have also your honey, Bulgaria. So our self-consumption is not sufficient. We need to import, even though we have some years very good production. And you can see that in some years we lack stock, and the beekeepers lack stock. They do not have enough money to furnish the market. Okay, we have challenges. Our winter losses are around 15% per year. It's not that high. We have two varroa-free regions still. Up in the north, in Lapland, and Åland archipelago. It's recognized by the European Union. But we have birds. They are increasingly causing troubles. And hopefully we have negotiated with the government that the government provides for any damage that the value is over 170 euros, any damage is being paid back. So the value of the colony. You need to simply fill in the form and make the pictures. But this is more than 100 beekeepers per year are concerned. This is a very good year. This means in Finland a very good year at the end of July. And this is a very normal summer. Winter. The beehives are covered by snow completely. And if you want them in April when the spring arrives to fly away, you need to dig it out. Okay. Now I will just show you something about the Finnish Beekeepers Association. The best is to go on the internet. We have a website. Unfortunately, most of it is in Finnish. But this is the most important tool we have. The government has cut subsidies when the financial crisis arrived in 2008. They removed support for research. The only research institute, or it was a unit, not even institute, in Finland was spread. So there is no research funded by the government. We need to introduce research projects on cooperation with universities and maybe co-financed by case by case by the government. We needed to handle a situation where our budget, the union budget, the association budget, was cut by one third because we haven't received subsidies. It doesn't matter. We coped with that. And this is people we basically pay from our membership fees. Look, we still have a limited budget, 5 people. Most of them are women. Young women, this is a scientist. And we have one person full-time, beekeeping advisor, paid by the EU national beekeeping project, like program for 3 years. We use part of this European money to pay the one full-time person. Limited resources, but quite a lot of things. The organization has local, regional associations, like members. I'm a member of this Southern Finnish Association. In my organization, we have about 180 members. We are the biggest in Finland. There are more than 50 of these local associations, and they are all part of the union. If I want to become a member of local organization, it needs to go through the central organization. I receive a membership fee invoice once a year. I paid it yesterday. And I pay a membership fee that is based on the local association's needs. So if I'm a member in the North Finland, I don't necessarily pay the same membership fee as in the Southern Finland. But we all pay, in addition to that, 1 euro a beehive. And this money is being used to make promotion program of honey to the public. This money collected from the beekeepers covers only 20% of the budget. 80% comes from the government. Promotional program to promote honey and beekeeping. So you don't need to be like, you can be involved at the regional level, but at the same time you are part of the national union. We promote lots of things through our website. It's like Estonian, the Finnish society is more and more based on internet, on social media. We need to be present. And our people do that. They are. We have a special website to promote Hunaja means honey. We publish recipes. We work with the chefs, with the cooks. They are our ambassadors to promote Finnish honey. We have also a special website to promote the role of pollination, because the role of pollination is far in value bigger than just honey. We have services for our members. This is the card where all the birds appeared last year. They are all over the place. I'm here. I haven't been affected, but maybe I will be thinking about putting a fence. We also have public events. We organize conferences, 3 major in a year. I need to pay to go there for 2 of them, so it's not free of cost. But we elect the best, every year, the best beekeeper. We elect the best honey, Finnish honey, of course. And also, in order to attract people to join our organization, we put clearly on the website what are the different things we do for the members. It's very important that you tell people publicly why they should join you. Okay? And we have also our Finnish quality honey mark recognition. It really concerns all food, not only honey. But this This is the Finnish Joutsen, meaning swan. That's the label of Finnish products, quality products. And our honey, if you want to be labeled with this, you need to have better criteria quality than the EU directive for honey. For instance, 18% of water content. HMFL, hydroxyl methylfurfural under 15, etc. So, very important to promote quality production and to be able to display it. And you can do it through the union, through the association. We have also published for those who would be concerned in English how to prevent these bear losses. So, we have international activities. Regarding international activities, we cooperate regionally. Actually, here, there is Baltic Apiculture Research Symposium and Nordic Baltic Bee Council. This is a very long cooperation between Nordic countries and recently Baltic states. Once a year, we meet, every year in a different country. It's something like Apislavia or the Balkan states cooperation. It's very important because you cannot be alone. You need to learn from your neighbors what they do. How do they deal with similar problems? How do they work with administration? Because diseases do not have borders, for instance. And now, this is major retailer, one of the two in Finland. 34% of the food market goes through this distributed S market. This is their rainbow mark. They sell, as you see, foreign honeys. Bunaya means honey. This one comes from Hungary, Acacia. And there is also Luomu, which means organic. If I look at this, it comes from Bulgaria. And it has been packed in Denmark. But I want to tell you, my friends, I'm happy that it's not a Chinese honey. It's a European honey. The only thing I would like to know is, where was it produced in Bulgaria? Where was it produced? Because I would love to visit the place. I would like to see. I would like to learn. And there's something, maybe, I don't know, how we can improve organic honey in a plastic jar. But it's not about Bulgarian beekeepers, it's about the Finnish buyers. To come to the end of my presentation, I think you will have a print of this. But this is a, what I would draw as key messages to our Bulgarian friends regarding the working government association. It's all about the people. If you don't have the right people in the right place, you can have good targets. It will be very difficult. But together you are always stronger. We know that from our experience and history in Finland. Together you are stronger. Find the right people. Cooperation delivers. Try to federate rather than divide. I mean, professional hobby beekeepers. I saw so many countries where they quarrel. There is a common interest. But please do it democratically. We have seen many people in our past who stick to their position. They fought and they still think they are the best. They have the best solutions. And then we convince them by voting that they should leave. They were replaced by younger people with new ideas. Okay, it was a good thing. And we do that every 2 years. I'm a member of the board of the Finnish Beekeepers Association. We are 9, not 8. You need to go forward. 5 against 4. But we are elected for 2 years. We can be re-elected, but it's very difficult. The organized sector is more credible if you speak to the authorities. We have very good relationship with the government agencies, with food safety agency, with veterinary authorities, and that's because we build it very long. We have good cooperation with the farmers too, even though we are not always on the same line. So dialogue and communication. Negotiations can be very difficult, but please do not stop the dialogue. And we work on the basis of annual plan. Every year we update our annual plan, and we, like in the old times of Soviet Union that I remember, we plan for 5 years. We have a strategy for 5 years, and we update it every year. It's very difficult to reach the targets, but you please have just five, not very quite high quantity of targets, but five targets and meet them. Priorities. One of our priorities is to work with youth, with young people. Young people are the future of the generation of our sector. We only started 2 years ago in Finland, and we want to build a national team to be part of the international young beekeepers competition that takes place every year. And I hope Bulgaria will be there one day too. So, building networks is also the fact that we are here with you today. We are open for your questions. Bagadari.
Сега, ако има някакви въпроси, знам, че има много, само ще ви помоля да са кратки, ясни и бързи, защото наистина времето е много. Давам подред на дигането на ръце Димо Димов. Заповядайте, господин Димов.
Благодаря.
Чува се добре,
дали? Не.
Дали?
Моят въпрос, сега съм наред работата, към преждеговорившите наши гости. Както към госпожа Хайнеман, така към господин Космос и господин Яс. Всички те засегнаха няколко важни за българските пчелари, бих казал даже един въпрос, а той е хаметовски за българските пчелари. Дали да членуваме в пчеларска организация или не? Затова моят въпрос към някои от тях, може би към госпожа Хайнеман, като най-така близка до нашата организация и структура на потребление и пари, които се разпределят. Въпросът ми е следният. Какво правите в Баварската асоциация с пчелари, които не са членове на вашата организация? Как подхождате към тях? Има ли такива, всъщност, първо? Защото не бих искал да дълго да дискутираме върху предимствата на членството на организациите. Предполагам, че това е ясно на повечето от нас. Обаче, тези, които не са членове на организацията, вашата, имат ли право да ползват тези средства, за които вие говорихте? По какъв начин те се включват в организационния живот, ако изобщо се включват? Или просто всеки действа самосиндикално? Въпросът ми е доста така дълъг, се получи усложнен, но в края на кращата е много важен за нас българските пчелари, защото ние имаме проблем именно с своята си идентификация към организация. Не, че сме против тях. Просто искаме да чуем вашия опит. Защо трябва да членувате в пчеларската организация? Един въпрос, който ме е подсказан за първо. Също. Дали бях ясен? Разбрахте ли?
In Bavaria, when you don't have to be a member of a social club. When you start with this beekeeping, you must go to the veterinarian and tell them that you have that you are a beekeeper. From the first hive, beehive, you have to go there and you get a number, and then they know, okay, if we have the American foulwood, we have problems with hills, then they know where are all the beehives. But you don't have to be a member. But in the local clubs, we try that everyone who is a beekeeper comes into a club, because my colleague told if we are many beekeepers, we can say in the government, in the ministry, what we want. And if the people work on their own, it is okay, but we will change in Bavaria that when you start, it is the future, it is a target. When you start with beekeeping, you must take part on, for example, how you work with a varroa, how you use the medicine. This should be the minimum if you are allowed hold bees, because bees are an animal, and you must understand and you must have a little bit education to be a beekeeper. This is, I think, if you are organized in a bee club, you learn and you talk together and you have targets and you be a good organization. And on top, the president can go to the government and can say, this is our program, that's what we want to do, and that's what we want to have. Yeah, I hope this is a little bit of answer.
Yes, this is very important questions. And we in Slovenia, as I told, we have about 75% of all beekeepers are in local beekeepers association and also in national beekeepers association. For 25% there we don't know yet, and this is quite big problem. And for those beekeepers, we don't have idea what to do that they will join to our organization. It is very hard, but it is almost impossible. It will be never 100%. But when we are thinking why we have 75% joined beekeepers in one national association, is the reason that we have one beekeepers magazine. This magazine gets each beekeeper who is joined to our association. So he paid 36 euros and he gets 11 numbers of this beekeeping magazine. And in this beekeeping magazine, it is all information he needs for his beekeeping. So therefore, without magazine, we will be not so successful. And in this magazine, it is scientific articles about beekeeping, also the shadow where is lectures and so on. Also, we have advertisements for some factories to produce beekeeping equipment and so on. And beekeepers want to get this magazine, and therefore they pay this fee that they are members of association. So it is the only beekeeping magazine in the Slovenia. So in this way we are doing in our country.
Сега да ви кажа, само.
Just briefly about the attracting beekeepers to the association. I agree with the fact that you will never have the situation like in Czech Republic, where 96% of the beekeepers are members of the union. You cannot have that in Finland. it's unrealistic. But we would like to keep at least this 75-80%, because we speak as this as the only one when we speak to the government, one voice. How do we attract them? The same similar way like in Slovenia, I heard. Only members who pay the 61 euro a membership fee per year, in my case, in some Finland, have access to the Viking Journal. We have only 6 numbers page. Then they have access to different reductions in price, because we have also a webshop. A webshop only for like publications. Obviously, they have also very easy access to this advisor, who is paid by the money, because he's paid by intermediary of the union. They can also influence, that's what we say. They can, if they are an idea, they can become members of the local association and they can influence, they can take part in the different events. They have access to also the beekeeping courses. Then they have access to a specific package, like we developed our union a package for honey, like it's not a bottle, it's a jar, and they, only these members can use this jar, obviously with their name, but only them. We also help them to submit forms to the administration. We help them to fill in forms if necessary. So they have the expertise, and that's about it. Then it's about people. So if our federation has good people, they will be attractive. If we are not active, they will.
По реда на вдигане на ръка, господин Михайлов.
Благодаря на организаторите за тази конференция. Смятам, че това е едно добро начинание. Поздравявам ви госпожа Габриел, инициатор, главен инициатор на форума. Тук бих искал да задам един въпрос, макар малко и страничен, но той е много важен. Какво прави администрацията, какво прави Европейския парламент, какво правят пчеларските среди, говорим в Европа, за това, че след около 4 години завършва следващия програмен период на ОСП 2020. Аз смятам, че още от сега трябва да се помисли за това, следващия, може би 7 годишен програмен период, да може пчеларите да получават директни субсидии, а не както сега да се правят опити с подпрограми, по някакъв начин да се облегчи положението. Това е във връзка с членството на пчеларите, защото те винаги казват какво ще ви донесе членството в дадена организация. Тогава, когато ние бъдем субсидирани, както останалите въдства, това съответно ще бъде на лице. Благодаря.
Сега, задайте другите въпроси и тогава да проверят, за да може, ако се повтарят или някой се засипсва, да е наведнъж. Господин Стефан, беше следващия.
Мой въпрос е към колегите, гости, пчелари. Ние с госпожа Габриел, като аз пчелар с 2000 колонии, а тя като представител на Европейското, така да се каже, общество на пчеларите, ще трябва после да отговорим. Възможно ли е в България да продължи да се развива пчеларството, където има около 600 000 пчелни семейства, без да има никакво училище за пчелари? Възможно ли е по ваше преценка?
Господин Кожухаров,
два въпроса. Един ми е към доктор Козмос. Значи, доста от участниците в залата сме присъствали на конгреса през 2003 година на Пимондия в Словения. Запознати сме с тяхното пчеларство, имат страхотна селекция, имат много добри традиции. От това, което той изложи, не разбрахме по какъв начин осигуряват средствата, за да упражнят тая дейност и долу-горе с какъв бюджет на година разполагат за селекционна дейност. И искам да направя тук една отметка. България, пчелните продукти, дори и от водките, се продават на 80% от себестойността им. Бихме ли могли ни да заделяме при това положение средства за организационна дейност, да издържваме браншови организации и да бъдем конкурентни в тая среда, в която в момента съществува с монополия, с сериозен натиск от определени институции? Това ми е въпросът. Към госпожа Хайнеман. България произвежда около 10-15 хиляди тона пчелен мед на година. Голяма част от тях, много голяма част от тях заминават като износ за Германия. Много голяма част от този износ е на биологичен пчелен мед. Никъде обаче в страни от Европейската общност, пък и други части на света, нашия мед не го срещаме като краен продукт. Изнасяме го за Германия като суровина и оттам някъде изчезва и никъде не се появява като краен продукт. Би ли могла да кажа ли тяхните големи преработватели, Ламберт, Кирш, Волф, какъв начин процедира с нашия продукт и защо той не достига до крайен потребител като продукт, произведен в България? Това не са двата въпроса.
Добър ден, колеги.
Здравейте, колеги. Първо да поздравим за добре дошли на гостите от чужбина. И понеже всички, които се изказаха, става на въпрос, че навсякъде се говори за обучение. От тук присъстващите колеги от различни организации, може би дори не са и наясно, че аз като представител на Федерацията на българските пчелари, тук колеги около мен, ние в България направихме през 2015 година първото училище за пчелари. Училището е напълно безплатно и в момента е в Берковица. Там в момента се провеждат занятията. До мен е колега Кънев. Той също прави някаква образователна и последна дейност в град Русе по училищата. И просто да споделят опит колегите, как при тях са чисто нормативно устроени нещата, как държавата обръща внимание на такива училища и какво правят областните, националните организации, дори и общинските. И още един въпрос имам. Как се справяте чисто като дружества, като асоциации, понеже колегата каза, че от 2 години нямат отровени пчелни семейства, как държавата помага на обикновения пчелар 2 години да няма отровено семейство? Това са ми двата въпроса.
Колегата не му знам името
си. Симеон Николов. Уважаеми господа, чули се. Много се радвам, че имам възможността да задам един важен въпрос за българските пчелари, а именно реализацията на нашата продукция. Трябва да уведомя гостите, че България е на второ място в света по разнообразие на билки на квадратни километри, от което следва, че нашия мед, въпреки нашата квалификация, е един от най-добрите. Ако ви се поинтересувате за изходната цена, по-добре е да не се интересувате. Въпрос. Ясно, че Европейската комисия по обща селскостопанска политика стимулира земеделските производители по три начина. Първи, директни плащания. На нас не са полагат. Втори начин, пазарна подкрепа. Да съществува ли такова понятие във вашата държава или аз просто съм сънувал? И трето, експортна подкрепа. За експортна подкрепа, доколкото разбирам, не достигат финансите на Европейския съюз. Нямаме претенции да се продавам меда в Индия и Европейската комисия да ми доплаща разликата. Нямаме такива претенции. Аз имам претенции да се ми платят 4,5 евро, колкото е в момента пазарната цена в Европа. Въпросът ми е лесен И има втори въпрос. Доколкото разбирам, Европейския съюз, 505 милиона човека, в селското стопанство се занимава само по-малко от 6% млади хора. Нали така, госпожа Кадриева? Въпрос. Каква е стратегията за развитието на вашите държави за привличането на млади хора към пчеларството? Аз свърших, но вие ми зададете тези въпроси, аз бих казал. Преди да почнат, докато навършат 40 години по 2000 евро на месец. Малко кръгът на шегата. Благодаря ви за вниманието.
И последен въпрос, Манол Тодоров, защото времето наистина много напред.
Благодаря. Имам един единствен въпрос към доктор Космос. Вие цитирахте много добри цифри, как производителите продават на ускорение 80% от газа, как от 4 на 8 е скочила цената. Моят въпрос е следния. Това са много хубави неща, но платира знаят, че Словения е държавата, която си е регистрирала словенски мед като защитено географско указание. Моят въпрос е към вас е следния. България сега няма такъв продукт, но мен това живо ме интересува, тъй като ние един екип работиме върху регистрация на стани самарбет като защитено географско указание. Въпросът обаче ми е следния. Как в Словения успеха колегите да регистрират, говоря за 6 или 7 вида мед, по-скоро 7 вида мед, като словенски мед? Тоест, какви доказателства вие успяхте да регистрират, няма проблеми, но въпросът ми е, какви доказателства вие успяхте да намерите? И, например, акация в мед от България, какво се различава акация в мед от Словения или обратно? Благодаря ви.
Okay, I will start. Firstly, about budget, which is going to the selection for Apis mellifera carnica, maybe budget for Slovenian Beekeepers Association, we have about 1.4 million euros, which is operate on the Slovenian Beekeepers Association, and 130,000 euros are going to the selection, but not just the Slovenian Beekeepers Association, and also to the Agriculture Institute of Slovenia. This is the number, and this is the answer on this question. Regarding poisoning honeybees in the field, few years ago, as I mentioned, we have a lot of poisoning in our country. In one region, more than 20 beekeepers in the same time. From then on, our ministry prohibited use of neonicotinoids and some other pesticides. And also each spring we are doing a lot of on information of farmers when they must use pesticides, in which way. We find out that poisoning mostly happens if they are farmers use it in vineyards, and when they are also spray the apples tree. And then we learn them that they must grass, cut grass before they use these pesticides. And all these things, because we learn it, we believe that this is the way how it comes that last 2 years we didn't have any poisoning bees in the whole area in the Slovenia. Regarding Slovenian honey, yes, we have our brand Slovenian honey. We are very glad because our people know that if they bought a glass of honey where it's written that it is Slovenian honey, that it is from Slovenia, this is very good. We have some problems that this price is a little bit higher if they go to the Lidl or Hofer, and then it's the same amount of glass and the price it is 5 or 6 euros, and this Slovenian honey it is 8, 9 or 10 euros. We don't have just Slovenian honey, but we have also Krashki. This is honey from one region, and also Kojewski med. So we have three brands of honey, which are very known in the Slovenia. But regarding the process which we use, that we get this brand, I don't know, because it is it worked one other person on this. And we are just glad that we have it, and we have also one special glass for the honey, which is very nice shape. So the customers in the shops, they saw in the big distance, this is Slovenian honey, because it is not allowed to put in these glasses anything else, just Slovenian honey. And this is also one good, easy way how to learn consumers to buy Slovenian honey. And this is probably all from my side.
There was a question about how getting young beekeepers and beekeeping on schools. In Germany, we, in Bavaria, we have a project called beekeeping, test beekeeping. Our organization, the Bavarian organization, goes to the ministry and says we want to get young beekeepers and we need money. So in the local clubs beekeeping, for every young or for every new interesting in beekeeping, when they take part on 1 year and he can take part 2 years education, you get every year 100 euro. And the same is a program for beekeeping on schools. Last year, I know there were 300 euro from our government for a school when they did beekeeping on schools. And from this money, you have to you can buy or you, what you need, clothes or something, what you need for the beekeeping, you can buy that from that from this money. But at the end, to get 100 euro for a new beekeeper, you have much writing. And at the end, we say, we don't need the money. We, when in the local clubs, it's a good working together, and we have good teachers, and the teachers go to the institute, to an institute once a year, and take part on a, on a, one day you get information about beekeeping, bee health, and breeding. It does not cost you something. This is something from the ministry, what we get. But at the end, I'm in a situation, every year my course starts at the end of February, and I have 50 new starters, and in the next county, they, or next county and next city, they have 70 new starters. And this is an activity if you want it or if you want it not. So, if you are interested in this or not.
Аз само ще отговоря много кратко на въпрос, който беше адресиран на Европейски парламент и Европейска комисия. С бъдещето на ОСП след 2020, това трябва да бъде разглеждано в контекст на това, че не, до този момент не са започнали дискусии по тази тема и тя е логично. Само да ви напомня, че само преди година стартира новия период. Ако през 2017 година най-напред не направим ревизия в първо време, на която се вижда какво работи първите 2-3 години, какви са новите тенденции, кои са секторите, които имат нужда повече от субсидии или не, в този момент вече готовността ще бъде различна на въпроса, да видим каква е перспективата. Но за момента аз искам да ви привлека вниманието към най-важното. Нека не губим от поглед тези, които е важно да бъдат съюзници на каузата. Европейски парламент е ваш съюзник. Европейска комисия е наш съюзник. Съвета на министрите си насочете вниманието. Защото там държавите членки нямат единна позиция. Там решението, когато става въпрос за такива важни въпроси, не е само мнозинство обикновено. Така че според мен тук е много по-важно да се говори. Всеки един от вас има контакти с пчелари от други страни. Собствените им министри на съвет министрите да защитят тази позиция. Защото мога да ви уверя, че въпреки, че тази идея получи много голяма гласност вследствие и на усилията, които положих в Европейски парламент и наистина прекрасната подкрепа, която успях да си осигуря от моите колеги, защото трябва да си припомним, единият със законодател в Европейски парламент гласува за директна субсидия и за този програмен период. Съветът на министрите не пожелай да чуе нищо по тази тема. Така че в този момент е много по-важно да не губим от поглед, че в съвета на министрите се вземат крайни решения и е важно там да продължим да насочваме усилия. А що се отнася до Европейски парламент, аз в този контекст излизам и с много повече възможност за активизация по темата, защото не случайно споменах, че председателство на работна група по пчеларство и здраве на пчелите. В тази работна група сме си съставили един малък екип от най-силно заинтересовани европейски депутати с тази тема. Имайте предвид, че това е ново, защото и много нови колеги имаме. С тях разбира се, че всяка една такава възможност за подобряване състоянието на сектора няма да бъде пропусната. Но не е в момента това на дневен ред. Следим. Стане ли време, ще бъдем сред първите активи.
And not so many things, just like we speak of the school at the European level, there was a situation in a different country, I can tell you that the school, except for the new category, that we can find this kind of school nearly everywhere in all the countries in Europe, a school with a for professional beekeeper. There are some countries with specific school. In France, you have all the system of schooling there. In Poland, in Czechia, and some different countries, they have specific teaching for this. And at the university level, there is only one school in the UK. So it's just a school. But there is no specific program in our country, in our region. We just now put in place a specific program for the new beekeeper. And it's adapted by the region, and all the school has to fulfill this kind of program. If you didn't receive some money, and the money for the school, for all the school, it's normally a national program, it's never a European program.
I have a few comments. First of all, I forgot maybe to mention two important points, how to attract people to the union. We in Finland also have negotiated with an insurance company that if you are a member of the union, you get either some sort of insurance, like insurance of damage you can cause by your product to the consumer, but also you can have reductions on, for instance, house insurance. So this is one of the things. Second is, we are basically the only organization in Finland with credible statistics on the beekeeping sector. Without us, the ministry wouldn't have credible statistics. And we do that based on one survey. We take 10% of our members and we send them every year the questionnaire. On top of that, we do a market research, so we collect honey prices across the country and prices that honey is bought by the packers. And this is also provided to our members. So data, please, data. This is also very attractive for some people. Now, betting on the export. I think the problem with European Union providing export support for honey is that Europe is not self-sufficient in honey production. It's very difficult if you want to export European honey. What is European honey? We have Slovenian honey, we have maybe Finnish honey, Bulgarian honey, but you have also Bulgarian linden honey. You have Bulgarian very good honeys, by the way, I tasted today. So there is no such thing like European honey, and even if there was the European honey, we need to import into Europe almost half of what we consume. So it will not get support from the European Union. But you can develop market niches. I can give you an example. We had in Finland a year ago, we had Chinese interested in quality Finnish honey. They paid better if there is enough in huge quantities, and these were tons possibly of honey, Finnish honey. That would be sold at a very good price on Chinese market. And then they export the Chinese honey to Europe. But you see, it's a market niche, it's a market opportunity. We do not produce enough honey in Finland for our consumers, but we still have specialized producers who sell to German market Arctic honey from a certain region. So they know how to brand it. Please do not forget, there are different honeys. There is not such a thing like only, okay, Slovenian honey or Bulgarian honey, maybe, because it's the country where it's produced. But you may produce by market niches. And on that, you can get maybe support from your national authorities and the ministry, from the trade or ministry, for instance. So this is in brief.
Украински за първият панел приключих. Предлагам 15 минути пауза, защото сме много напред във времето и да продължим след това.